director producer of Living Rock Ministries. We're a ministry that's located in Webster, New York, outside of Rochester, New York. Our ministry purpose is reaching youth for Christ through music. And today they've asked me to kind of like moderate and be here with you to introduce Roger Martinez, who is the lead singer from Vengeance Rising. He's a minister in the Assembly of God Church out in California, Sanctuary Church. We're all ministers.
Sanctuary Hollywood. It's a non-denominational church that holds to historic orthodoxy, basically, you know.
But, praise the Lord. We should have two microphones. Here's what we're going to do today. It's an open forum. I know there's a lot of you out there that have questions about whether or not heavy metal music is of God. There's probably some people out there that have some questions about heavy metal music and its purpose and its ministry use in spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ. If you've got questions, we're going to try and go through them real orderly. Let me know what your questions are. You can direct them to either Roger or myself, and we're just going to let the Holy Spirit lead the entire afternoon. Right. Amen? So, let's just bow our heads and pray before we begin. Father God, we thank you for this opportunity to join together in fellowship and to come together to have a better understanding of your word. Father, we ask that the right questions would be asked today and that the word of God would go forth, that would not only give a peace and an understanding that maybe some of us don't have right now, but would also touch the hearts of those out there that maybe don't know you. So Father, we lift this afternoon up to you. We lift this entire effort up to you, Father God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And so, we begin. Anybody got any questions they want to start out with? She runs a ministry in Massachusetts.
Basically, what you'll find is with all of us in our conversion, there is a period of, and it's a lifelong experience of what we call sanctification, what the Bible teaches about what happens at the point of conversion. Now, sanctification and maturity is obviously a process that begins initially, but the timing and the way, the level of sanctification, meaning to which degree that individual in holiness centers their life more and more around the work and the world and the purpose of God will differ with each individual. So you'll find all of us today deal with things, different types of things that people deal with all throughout their entire lifetime. But at the same point, the main thing to do is to get them plugged into a good discipleship program, to have the fellowship, specifically the pastor, understand the necessity that you have a new convert. Because if the new convert isn't rooted immediately in the foundational truths of the Word of God, a seminar I did this morning on the doctrines of salvation, if they don't understand what justification is, and sanctification, propitiation, atonement, imputation, the simple milk of the Word of God from Romans and Galatians, then they can very easily slide back into the things and the things that Satan will provide because of the fact that they don't understand what faith is. Because when we minister to an individual, in my personal perspective, the reason we never have altar calls at our church is because if someone wants to give their lives to Jesus Christ, we want to be able to personally spend with them time to explain to them what repentance is, what sin is, what remission of sin actually means, what it is to be converted, what it is to give the life, what is the imputed righteousness, these types of issues. And once an individual, see, because you have two different things in the world. You have regeneration and you have reformation. Now, what many people try and do is they want some genie bottle God, okay, well, I'll just call him out when I need him, and they'll reform. They might quit listening to a band, they might quit smoking, they might quit drinking, but that doesn't save anybody. Only by receiving Christ into the heart, which initiates what the Bible says God does in that person's life, which is regeneration, a work that cannot be done by man, then that person gets saved. So you want to make sure, because there's a very heavy word that the scripture uses. It's a very scary word. The word is many. In Matthew 7:21, the Bible says, many will come before the Lord and say, but Lord, I was casting out demons. I was even doing miracles in your name. And the Lord will look at some people and say, and the word says, many, depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. I never knew you. So what we're trying to do is make sure that they understand what true conversion is. Because a truly converted person will have a complete conviction when they know that they're out of the will of God. When they know when a man is completely slamming everything that Jesus Christ has directed for their life. So basically, you want to make sure that they're saved in the first place, because many people are claiming they are when they're not. And if a person can just flood back into listening to and doing the whole worldly scene, in my opinion, it's very likely that they were never saved in the first place. And that word many will come into play.
What was your second question? Her concern, correct me if I'm wrong, her concern is that it's so hard for the teenagers and for the youth to give up the rebellion and the idolatry of the secular music, okay?
I guess it goes kind of back to the original point that you really need to determine whether this person is saved, because if we read the scripture and the scripture calls us to a different standard, and we've been empowered by the Holy Spirit to have the fruit of the Spirit being an occurrence and a manifestation in our lives, we have a matter of obedience to obey, and we have the ability to obey by the Holy Spirit. And if a person is refusing to obey again or unwilling to, it's kind of like baptism. If someone claims that they're saved, but they say, well, I'm refusing to get baptized, in my opinion, they're probably not saved. Because God points out when you're saved, there are certain characteristics and manifestations in your life of obedience. And the whole point there would be that, you know, it's a very interesting thing that when the Bible says that Jesus Christ is coming back to destroy, it says he's coming back to destroy the sons of disobedience. So when the Bible says, children, obey your parents, for this is right in the Lord, but a child says, well, forget that, I would question, see, because it's, and it's important, and obviously you can't, you know, because you're not, none of us, there is not sinless perfection in orthodoxy. You know, we are not sinless, and that's why sanctification is in three tenses. We were sanctified from the penalty of sin. We are being sanctified in life right now by the daily repentance of any sin, thought, word, or deed. And we will be sanctified in the redemption of our body when we'll receive the new body, perfect, sinless, holy, uncorruptible, and that will live eternally. So basically, if someone is openly and blatantly just spitting on what God says, I would wonder whether or not they're believing. See, because take a look at this. Judas was the type of guy who came to a festival like this, and everyone said, hey, there's Judas. How you doing, man? They never thought that dude was a deceiver. They never thought he was a rat. He was a treasurer. They thought this dude was right on. So the thing is, there are people who even play a game, but yet they're never really there because they never made a hard commitment. They're perfect, you know what I'm saying? Those types of issues where in their heart, man, they're just not right on with God. And so it's important that we individually, as the Bible says, check ourselves to see whether or not we're in the faith. Because you will have those manifestations where you're going to, and there's going to be times when people get mad. There's going to be times, I mean, if somebody cuts you off on the freeway, you know, I said, well, praise God, brother, you know, that's just not real, that's not the real world. So, but, you know, you work with those things and you deal with those issues. Like, you know, one of the things I was pointing out to some other brother in earlier, you know, back when I was a gangbanger and I used to fight and I used to do these types of things, the whole issue is I could still be violent, I could still just nail somebody if they made me mad, but yet I choose not to. There was an instance as a believer too, we need to understand that if we see a brother sinning, the Bible says those of us who are spiritual restore such a one to fellowship, because there are believers who blow it. I remember this one time, I was in this grocery market, man, and check this out. This guy, this is after I first got saved, you know, I'm trying to walk the Christian walk, live the life, and the whole scene, right? So check this out, I'm there, and there's this guy, right? I put my bread on the counter thing, and this guy pushed my bread back. So what the heck is this guy doing? So I pushed my bread forward. And this guy pushed my bread back. So I pushed my bread forward. And he grabbed my shirt, my favorite shirt, and it ripped. I took the guy outside and pulverized his head. Now, I shouldn't have done that. I was wrong in doing it. It was a sin. I repented, and I haven't done it since. But Christians do blow it, you know. So So, you know, so if you see a brother sin, yeah, the Bible says rebuke, but in the essence, like I was this morning saying, in long suffering and patience, so that that person can be edified. I blew it, I sinned, I repented, and I said, whoa, Lord, you know, I blew it. And Christians sin. But there's a difference between being a sinner and sinning. A sinner is one who just flagrantly, that's life, that's daily life. A Christian, when he commits a sin, he gets convicted by the Spirit, man. He goes before the Lord in tears and says, Lord, man, I'm blowing it. You know? So there's a big difference there. So you need to be very careful and explain, make sure someone understands what conversion is, whether or not they're really saved. And if they are, explain to them the necessity of sanctification and holiness.
You know, a lot of the power that's involved in secular music, a lot of the idolatry, a lot of the power in secular music is because of the activity of the enemy that's kind of pervaded all of the lies. All right, and those lies are powerful lies, and they do grip the young people. They're deceived, you know, and as lies will go on and create more lies and more lies, and one lie becomes so powerful that it creates thousands and thousands of lies. So it is in secular music when they pervade all of this perversion and sexual freedom and drugs and all of these other things of the world. You know, I mean, it's all the enemy that's involved in that, and his power is strong, but it can be defeated and it can be overcome by Jesus Christ. So, anything else? Over here.
Have you ever been approached by a fundamental pastor or a fundamental pastor to sit down and talk to you about your goals, aims, etc.? He
wants to know if he's ever been approached by a fundamental pastor.
Yeah, but basically, again, because we hold to the fundamentals of the faith, and we do hold to historic orthodoxy. So basically, yes, there's several instances in which I've had the opportunity to, primarily those who are using logic, you know, reasonable logic, we discuss specifics with, and then we can come to an agreement with. Generally, they simply don't understand the ministry of vengeance, and they don't understand the ministry of sanctuary, but once they actually take a look at what's really happening, they actually generally come around. There's this one guy out there, major left field, his name's Jeff Godwin, and I address the dude. He has this book called Dancing with Demons, right? So basically we're doing a rebuttal to that called Dancing with Jeff Godwin. We talked to him and addressed the issues that he basically was just very hypocritically lying and slandering, defamation of character on the ministry and what have you, and he simply had no answers. He simply just reinstated his presuppositionalism that wasn't based in a biblical, a scriptural perspective, but he abandoned what we were doing for his own autonomous reasoning. He envisioned the fact that we were having moshing at the church and stuff, and it's like, hey man, we have your basic Baptist, good old Calvary Chapel type service is what sanctuary is all about. And people have this bizarre perception, and it's like, we try to reasonably, you know, talk to them, but yeah, most of the time they come around, but guys like him, unfortunately, just simply refuse to see what's going on, and so we'll be addressing, you know, that and several other issues in, like, the Heavens Melbourne, right through magazines and what have you. So yeah, but primarily, you know, if we deal from the scripture, it's become rather clear.
Right back. Okay, the question is your opinion and stand on moshing at Christian concerts.
Yeah, it's kind of like, here's my perception, it's kind of like football. You know, it's like if guys are out there and they're having a good time, and for them it's nothing but a bunch of fun, you know, that's cool, you know, and even in football, you know, it's like, they're like soccer, man. There was that soccer game last year. Dude, how many, like, what was it, like 400 people got killed because they were trampled to death at a soccer game. But I don't say, well, this acts all soccer. Or because someone gets hurt in football, I don't say, well, geez, football's of the devil. So basically, it's like moshing. Guys who are into it, most of the guys I know, they're just having a great time. You know, they're just, it's just a bunch of fun to them. And so, like I say, if it's fun to them and they're having a good time, and, you know, in my opinion, like football and like soccer, that's their choice and they're free to do it. And if they're having a good time in it, provided their lives are centered around Jesus Christ and that's part of their fun, it's cool, because there's a time for war and a time for play. And if that's part of their play, that's cool.
Somebody come over on this side. Go ahead.
Where do you think this is all headed?
Where is Christian heavy metal headed?
Basically, the whole purpose and intent of it, and it's directed into the local church. It's headed to see converts, and it's headed to really encourage the believers and new converts into a regular fellowship at their local churches, and to be actively involved in evangelism, discipleship, study. I really encourage people myself. My personal opinion is I would like to see, because when I look out over all of you, you know, what I see really are leaders in the Christian church. It's going to be a matter of time in your growth process. But for instance, there's a brother, he's an elder at our church in Hollywood. His name's Ski Goodhart, and he's going to Talbot School of Theology right now for his master's. My ultimate goal is to go to Stanford for my PhD. And so in my opinion, it's headed towards the leadership of the body of Christ, provided we understand that the concerts are, evangelism, having a good time, those types of things, but centered around, that's actually, it's weird, the concerts are actually quite a small segment of what we do. We have, our regular Sunday services, we have prayer meetings and Bible studies 5 nights a week. Outside of that, the concerts are here and there, and, on the tours, we're able to edify and minister at the different churches around the country. So basically, it's just where, what music is being created for is to edify believers and to win others to the lost and to praise God with. Those three things, actually, you can take those backwards in that order. To praise God with initially, you're going to see the lost saved, then to edify believers in praise and worship.
Roger, one of the things that I'd like to ask you, there's a lot of things that are happening right now within the church, with the youth in the church that are embracing Christian heavy metal, Christian rock. And instead of becoming a form of worship, it's becoming a substitution for what secular rock was in their life. Now, I believe that these people are still, they love the Lord and they're really in it, but for some reason or another, they tend to just simply take out A and put in B, all right? They still love the Lord, but they've kind of like substituted their secular idols with Christian idols, all right? How do we go about keeping the right perspective in Christian rock? How do we go about discipling the youth into using Christian rock as an evangelistic tool and not as a substitution for the secular burden?
At the same time, understanding that by all means our styles and music and our taste in music, well, if you've enjoyed a style of music, you may continue to enjoy it, and there's nothing wrong with that. But as he was saying, one thing that is important is that, because I remember when I first got saved, and really most Christian music to me sounded pretty lame. But what happened in my maturity process, and what many of you will find as you continue to grow and walk in the Lord, you will come to a different understanding. Meaning right now, my favorite band, and this blows people away, my favorite band right now, this changes month by month, because I might enjoy one band this month and a band the next, but is a band that's going to be playing tomorrow at noon. They're called Commission. And people think I'm in my car cruising around, But I'm sitting there listening to Commission, singing praise tunes, and singing praise right along with them. And I'd encourage you guys to go check them out tomorrow at noon. They're going to be ripping these dudes, man. I saw them up in Chicago, and I was blessed, man. These dudes rip. And so, you can enjoy that style of music and still have it, because I still listen to, some heavy stuff, too, on occasion. But when I'm at home, what I listen to generally is more mellow stuff, and I do a lot of studying and reading. So by all means, in using, the music as a tool, and also, it's music that you like that's cool, you need to make sure that you grow into a praise mode where you can understand that the praise music that you hear on Sundays, that needs to become a very important part of your life. Like those of you who are over with Sacred Warrior right now, as we ended with Holy, 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 that's what it should all come down to the praising of the Lord. And if you're in the one style of music, but yet you can't raise your hands and say, Lord, I give you nothing, but may you have all. 3 minutes of my life, Lord, I have nothing to bring, but I give you my life, that you might do with it what you will. Hey, man, when you're doing that, man, you're going to get blessed. And that's a mode that you need to enter into if you're not already there. And the thing is, I know many of you right here, you might even think you're too young. You might think that maybe because of your age, you can't be serving God like some of the guys who are, whatever age. And you think, well, gee, I'm too young. Maybe I'll get there. But if you take a look in the Bible, man, Jesus Christ was our prime example at age 12 in the temple. We have Daniel. We have Joseph. We have Samuel. All of these powerful and mighty people of God all started out at the age or younger than you guys are right now. So understand, if you take a look at Spurgeon, All of these radical preachers, man, they were all 18, 19, 20 years old, and they were ripping. So don't let your age, man, even begin to think that somehow you'll achieve something, because God wants you working actively in ministry now. He wants you to understand that perspective now. Don't let your age have nothing to do with it, because it doesn't. It's your spiritual age and the growth and maturity in the spirit that's important.
On the back, young lady. Excited about Jesus Christ. They're not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ when they're in the concert environment, watching the groups and everything, and surrounded by fellow Christians that are also not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. But when they go into the secular high schools, how do we support them?
Here's a heavy point. You see, the rock that we stand on is the authenticity of the Word of God and the person and work of Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary. Here's a major factor that's going to play into your daily life and in the way that you daily minister. Educate yourself as to why you believe what you believe. Josh McDowell, a guy who's here this weekend, has some excellent materials like that. A guy who worked on some books with him, Don Stewart, is the guy that we had doing the theological review on our last album, Once Dead. What you want to do is understand this, because you know how I came to faith in Christ was I had a question. Here I was, a dude living what most people would dream the Hollywood party lifestyle, living up in the Hollywood Hills, having the coke parties, having all the rock and roll, all the chicks, the whole deal, and everyone said, oh gee, that's a dream lifestyle, you know what I'm saying? But let me tell you something, I began to have a question, because I saw, like the Bible says, Solomon, man, he had everything, and at the end of it all, he said, hey, without God, man, this is all futile. The point being that I had a question, I said, okay, well, if this is going to end up with emptiness, what is the truth? And here I have Hinduism telling me they've got the truth. Here I have the Buddhists telling me they've got the truth. Here I have these Christians telling me they've got the truth. Here's Islam telling me it has the truth. Here's these Jehovah's Witnesses, these Mormons. Here's all of these people, and they all claim they got the truth. What's going on? And so what I did was a comparative religion study on both sides of the coin. Why people were into it, and why people said it was totally off the wall. And the more I began to research these things, the more Orthodox biblical Christianity kept coming up on top. And how you're able to do that is to know that what you believe is the truth, the only truth that's going to get people into the kingdom of God. Because you're going to find all of it, look into them. Because what you have is the reality that God is going to judge the sons of disobedience. There are two families that are walking on this planet. There's a family of God and there's a family of Satan. And Jesus Christ said, hey, when he spoke to the Pharisees, he said, you are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father you do. So we need to understand that we have brothers. You see, everybody in the world is our brother. They may not be our brother in Christ. And if they're not, they are our brother in Adam. And because of that fact, we should care about them, understanding that Satan has been ripping them off. And when you understand the truth upon which you stand, that the Bible in which you hold in your hands is the word of the Almighty God, that the God's plan of redemption is the only way to the kingdom. When you understand the fallacies of these different groups, as I was pointing out this morning, you know, there are those of you who are sitting here, and you've had things happen bad in your past. You have memories of your past things, man, you wouldn't like to have. And why did those things happen to you? You see, in Hinduism, the reason they happened to you is because you deserved it. There's no grace and no mercy, not to mention the fact that the Vedic literature, once you research it, you're talking total myth and legend. But the point being, the Bible points out the only reason things like that happen is because God loved and gave a perfect plan, and sinful man abandoned God's plan. They full on abandoned God's plan, and in their selfish desires and their selfish self-will, said, get lost through the Bible and implemented their own systems, and that's created the wars. That's created what's happening. You know, I hear all these bands talking about how Christianity and this and that's full of hypocrisy. What a bunch of nonsense. Any person who even superficially took a look at what the Bible teaches truly about that would understand, no, because we're not preaching self-righteousness, but we are preaching that God has a perfect plan of redemption. We are saying that we can be saved based upon His blood at Calvary. You know, so it's heavy. Here's how you can do it, because a lot of times what happens is they begin talking to people at school, or they begin talking to someone or a teacher who comes up with a philosophy or an ideology, and they don't know how to answer it because they haven't educated themselves. And again, I pointed this out this morning. One main ways you can judge your spirituality is by how you spend your money. Now, here's the issue. What I want all of you in here to do is to begin. It's my personal belief that each one of you should begin building your own personal library. And in that library, gaining the materials. Every time someone asks you a question, we're not computers. We're not robots. We don't know it all. If someone asks you a question you don't know, don't let that thwart you. Simply write it down and research it. And you're going to find out Jesus Christ coming up on top. Because you're going to find a bunch of philosophical arguments. People who have been trained in cultic systems, who have certain philosophies, and they already know the logic of that philosophy. They use doublethink when you use terms. That's why ministries such as CRI, the Christian Research Institute, it's important that you utilize ministries like that, that you utilize ministries like Sanctuary, that you utilize ministries like what Josh McDowell has to better educate you as to the truth and the facts. I mean, people come over to my house and they say, well, Roger, I see all your books, but why do you have a Bhagavad Gita here? Why do you have the Book of Mormon? Why do you have the Quran? So that I can show anytime I meet one of those people what's wrong in those books. But again, understanding all your gaining of knowledge and wisdom, that you don't use it just to win arguments. Because the Bible says that knowledge puffs up, but love edifies. That you do it because you have a genuine concern for people, not just to win an argument. That when you talk to someone and you know they're wrong, you know they're full on just blowing it, that you don't go, nah, you're so wrong, you're just a loser. No, but that you minister to them so they understand you care about them. Because they'll pick it up like that, man, if you don't care. When I sat down with Tom Araya from Slayer to tell him about the gospel, had I just been trying to win a trophy, he would have picked it up. You see what I'm saying? You got to be, the only reason you should really be talking to me about Jesus Christ is because you care about him. When I sat down with Mike from Suicidal, the whole point was he understood that I was there because I had something that I cared about him for. And even to this day when I talk to these guys, the point being that anytime you deal with anybody, you got to do it because you're genuinely concerned about them. You know, I hear a lot of people slam bands out there. And I ask those people, well, how often do you pray for them? Where is your heart for them? Have you prayed for their salvation? They're lost, man. Satan's blinded them. Don't you care about that? And that's the thing. When you gain that care, because you understand we were in the same boat. We're all in the family of man. Some are brothers in Christ and some are brothers in Adam, but we're all brothers. So let's care about them.
There's another way you can help the children when they go into their schools, and that's by building a library of music. And one of the nicest things about Christian bookstores is that they've got open cassettes with liner notes and lyrics that you can read before you buy the tape, so that you will be able to prayerfully and diligently be able to research the lyrics and find out who they're trying to minister to. Certain groups minister to people that have got drug problems. Certain people minister to people to encourage them that are already saved. Some people in the Christian body that are performers and entertainers and evangelists minister to people that may be gripped by depression. You will be able to discern who they are trying to minister to by reading the lyrics. And there will be people in your life and people in your children's life that may have a problem, maybe in depression, maybe having suicidal thoughts. There may be kids that may be gripped by drugs. There may be kids that are just depressed because of a family situation that need to be encouraged and uplifted. You'll be able to share music as a ministry tool by helping your children spread that word, spread the gospel, spread the truth through music. Music is a very, very wonderful tool if you read the instruction book. You have to read the instruction book. An electric saw is a dangerous tool if you put it in somebody's hand and never tell them how to work it. But if they know how to work an electric saw, they can build things very, very quickly and with great precision and with great beauty. Okay? But they have to know how to use it. And I ask you that if your children are listening to Christian heavy metal that is ministering to people that are on drugs or that are lost, and it's really ministering to people that are lost, what is it doing to build you up? What is it doing to build your children up? Be aware also in the Christian world and in Christian music to make sure that it's edifying to their spirit, that they're using the world as the music as an encouragement and as a ministry tool and not as a substitute. But yes, you can help these kids, and you can get involved in youth ministry in your church and get grounded in the youth ministry and start spreading around, you know, discern, get groups and help support groups coming in for ministry and get counselors, you know, within your church that will minister by praying and getting into their lyrics and know exactly who you're trying to reach. There are areas around this town that I know for a fact are gripped by Satan worship. I know that. There are people right now that, as a matter of fact, and I'm going to call for prayer at the end of this thing today, but there's a black mass that's being said in a town called Palmyra, which is about 80 miles east of here. It's being said tonight. Okay, and we're going to pray about that later. Okay, because I rebuke right now in the name of Jesus anything that's going to happen there. That's 80 miles away, but it's only this far away from God. Okay? We can minister to people with music. There's guys right now, like, I'll tell you, Vengeance Rising is a form of music that ministers to a group of kids out there that may never hear the Word of God if we don't get some of those tapes or at least get that music to their ear. I mean, they'll hear it. I'm convinced that God's going to spread the Word and the Gospel to everyone. I know that every single person that He puts on this earth is going to hear the Gospel so that they've got the choice. But we can do our part as evangelists by taking some of this music and discern who of our friends, who in the school are thrashers or moshers, or who are druggies and who are skaters and who are what kind of music they like. This is the first time in the history of the world that the society in the United States and all the class and all the caste systems, everything else, all the groups in school are all determined by what music you like. It's incredible. Never before has music been such an important part of a child's life. And never before has God given us such an important and edifying tool, not only to build up the body and edify the body, encourage the body, but to evangelize. There's a couple of bands out right now called Tourniquet and, of course, Vengeance Rising that have all the scriptural references to every one of the lyrics on the song in the liner notes. And the question is whether or not this is something that's becoming widely spread, if this is something you're going to continue or when.
Yeah, and the second half to that was, for those of you listening to the tape, the theological review that was done by the guy down at CRI and also by Don Stewart, who did our last album. Yeah, the reason that we did that, I was, I get the Christian Research Journal, which is something you all should really get. It's a really good magazine through CRI down in Orange County, or actually San Juan Capistrano. You can call area code 714, you know, 555-1212, ask for CRI, get their number, and get the Research Journal. They have a broadcast that's on, I don't know if it's here, but I would imagine it is, because they get calls from New York every day. They're on KKLA as 99.5 back home in LA. But the thing about it is that Ron Rhodes, who ranks in there, you know, gave that as a suggestion. And that's one of the things, when you see the writings of some of the men of God whom you respect, by all means, man, that's the whole thing. You put it into practice. You put it into use. So he said, you know, what should be done? And although, like, okay, we know that our lyrics are right on anyway, but we did it, we went ahead, and we wanted other bands to recognize that fact. Because I'll be quite frank with you. Some people send me lyrics, you know, at my pad and stuff. And dude, some of this stuff is gnarly, man. I mean, it's like way out in left field. It's like, you know, we're going to smash Satan's head. We're going to rip him and beat him in the face till he's dead. I mean, you know, you're not going to smash Satan in the face, you know. It's like, you know what happens when you say, I rebuke Satan, man? He just laughs, man. I'll tell you what, because not even Michael the Archangel did that. The only person, you always need to be Jesus Christ-centered, never Satan-centered. Never center your prayers. Don't try talking to demons, man. The only time you do that is an actual demonic possession. And you need to check that out, because most of what's happening in this country is nothing like in Los Angeles, man. We have a bunch of cats that are just wigged, man, flipped. It's like this one chick came to our church in Hollywood, right? And she just flipped out, man. And everyone thought, oh, man, this chick's demon-possessed. And I wasn't there that Sunday. And some people tried casting demons out of her. I found out later as I went over, because she got arrested on the street and the whole deal, man, and I went over to talk to her. She was a manic depressive. One simple little medical thing calmed her because it was a chemical imbalance. And see, back in Southern Cal, man, back in 1982, the government cut off funding from all of these mental institutions, and they literally let these people out in the streets. So you get a lot of people dealing with all of these types of physical and diseases and stuff, and they're wigged out. People are saying they're demon possessed, and it's actually a small little chemical. It's a chemical imbalance, because this is a corrupt world under entropy, the second law of thermodynamics. In the closed system of creation, everything is winding down, and that's why the whole DNA factor, when you get into the mutations and people's minds not being, you know, all clear, yeah, there's a number of factors that deal with that, but the basis, you want to keep it God-centered. And I would encourage you guys to send your lyrics to people whom you respect, men of God, preferably PhDs, you know. I mean, I'll do it for you, but I'd rather you send it to someone who's going to get what I'm working towards getting. I mean, just for the sake of accountability and credibility. But nevertheless, in any case, it's something that we're hoping the fans will follow the example, because we're going to continue doing it anyway. Even if I had a PhD, I'd still give it to someone else and check this out, because that's what you always want to do, because none of us are infallible. And so we always need to, like, the iron sharpens iron. We need to, the brethren I like hanging out with are brethren who are full on hardcore into the word, man. We're gonna always be checking each other, and it's cool.
Okay, the gentleman with long hair would like to know, because of we'd like to know the your opinion on the scriptural stand about long hair.
Now, here's a real heavy point, and I don't mean to be putting you on the spot, but do you know where the scripture is? Oh, I know. No. Okay, here's what I'm saying. Here's the point, and because check this out. What you need to do, now I have an 11-page answer to that chapter. But the point is, the issue is, you're not even actually familiar with where it is in the Bible. And I'm not gonna, I don't mean to be putting you on the spot, but here's what I'm trying to say. If there's an issue in the scripture, we need to know what that issue is, where it is, what the Bible teaches on that issue, and be able to have studied the Word of God to know that. Now, the whole point being, I have an 11-page answer to that, because if you take it exegetically, which is to pull out of the scripture what it is teaching, as opposed to what people, there's what is called inferential theology. People will infer upon a text something that simply isn't there. Dr. Martin, the late Dr. Walter Martin, used a great illustration. He said people do this. For instance, I could say, well, Judas went out and hanged himself. Go thou and do likewise. You see, you can teach anything if you wanted to. But if you'll notice, in that chapter, verse 16 says, we nor the churches of God hold these customs. Right there in the context, it explains that that's not an issue. It was a sociological issue that they dealt with in the first century. That's why it said women must wear head coverings. But how many churches have you gone in where they wear head coverings? They understand that there was a sociological first century issue that wasn't in it, because it was God who commanded Samuel and Samson not to cut their hair. Now, they say that God is like flip. No, it's basically, it was something that they dealt with in that culture. And it does speak about men not being effeminate. I mean, you know, now, I'm not going to imitate one, but you know what I'm talking about. You know, some dude who's just not, you know, he's like, hey, what's up here, you know. So, the point being, yeah, we're not to be effeminate. I mean, you know, and it's like my wife. I'm married to this gorgeous, beautiful fox, man. I mean, we're talking, and she wouldn't have married me probably by short hair, because she just don't dig dudes with short hair, you know. She thought, hey, this dude's cool. So, you know, it's like, you know, and so there's different sociological factors. I mean, this is just how we grew up. It wasn't anything that was shocking to society. This was the norm and the average in Los Angeles.
I'd also like to add to that about long hair, though, and I think you have to be cognizant of this. If you are living in a home, and you have to come under the authority of your parents, and if that's a problem in your home, you cannot be rebellious. You know? You cannot be rebellious. You must be under authority of your father, of the head of the household. And if your father does demand that the hair is cut, you know, I mean, I've got long hair, and I'm under the authority of my pastor. If my pastor came to me tomorrow and told me, you got to cut your hair, you know, if I wanted to stay under his authority, and if I respect this man and his authority, first I will cut my hair out of respect. then I'm going to pray. And I'm going to pray very dutifully. I'm going to get into the Word. I'm really going to study. And if the Lord directs me into a different area and under new authority, that's fine. But I will not show any rebellion. Because it's just not worth it. And in the home, the Lord and the Scriptures clearly say that we are under that authority, you know. And you can't stand there and say, well, you know, don't let that come between you and the Lord. You know, don't let little things like that. I mean, I know there's a lot of people that at certain points in their life, their hair is a real big deal, you know, and stuff like that. But we can never let something in the physical come between us and our spiritual relationship with the Lord. Okay, never.
Yeah, and you know, that's a really important point, because I talk to a lot of people who, you know, they want to go out and win the world for Christ, but yet they're not a witness and a testimony at home. And if you're living under your home, it is important that you're a witness and a testimony to your parents. If they say don't listen to vengeance, don't listen to vengeance. If they say cut your hair, cut your hair. You need to be a witness and a testimony to them. There's going to come a time when you're an adult and you're going to be able to make your own decisions, but you need to obey the word of God. And how can we possibly go out and win the world if we're not even obedient to our own parents, you know, in reference to that aspect of it? And so I just would really encourage you, there are things that they're going to require of you, and for the time being, for their sake, man, and to minister to their need, do it and have them see. And in due time, if you choose, when you're in your own place, you're making your own money and what have you, yeah, obviously, you'll be able to do whatever you want to. But it is important that we obey Scripture and not disobey it. That is a really heavy point. I think this bro is going to.
What are you guys mentioning
still
out
Okay, a lot of questions. How long did it take you to write Mulligan Stew? How can you get a hold of the bass lines for the music, and when's the Sanctuary Church going to come to New York?
Okay. Real quickly, before I forget, if anyone of you gets to meet or talk to Frank Peretti, if you'd let him know, I'd really like to talk to that guy. I hope I get to meet him while he's here. I don't know, but in any case, that's besides the point. But so if you do, let him know. I'd love to see him this weekend, hopefully. In any case. Mulligans, oh darn, it's weird, man. Songwriting's really weird for us. We just kind of do it, you know. It's I don't know, I guess we never thought about it, you know. We never really thought about it. As for, what was the second part? Oh yeah, the bass lines. Roger Martin, our bass player, has a full-on complete bass video. I think it's in the New Heavens Metal and or White Throne magazines. So you'd want to pick those up. He has a full-on, he'll show you on video how to do those and, you know, just his techniques and what have you. And as for Sanctuary, here's another really important factor, you guys. Because I know some people, you know, okay, I'm the pastor of the Sanctuary Church in Hollywood, California. And some people say, oh, Sanctuary, that must be a really cool place to go to. But what I'd like you to understand is that all churches are primarily, we're all saying the same thing. So the thing is, whatever church you're at, you need to be able to grow and be the light there, because we're all simply doing the same thing. You see, Sanctuary is really, we're just out there talking to people, we're evangelizing, we're into discipleship, we're into the Word of God. And I'm sure your churches are quite the same. So understand and come to respect the men of God who are in your church and as pastors and elders and deacons and what have you. Because it's really, you know, and just as yourselves in your own groups, really, once you dive into the more and more you get into the Word, the more and more you're going to learn to understand and love and respect those men and just to really see that whole perspective. So as for one coming to New York per se, I know that there's a lot of people out here who are already doing the exact same thing. It's just like, because like our whole perspective is we are neither of Paul nor of Apollos. So the name really isn't so much an issue. We're all just a body of Christ. If someone's in a denomination, that's okay. There's nothing wrong with that. It's just that, you know, we want people to not, that's why we've only allowed 4 sanctuaries to exist in the United States. It's because there could have been by now hundreds, but we just wanted people to understand that we're not, you know, we don't want to, you know, we just want people everywhere just to get into the gospel and forget the name thing. We just need something to identify ourselves with the state of California. So, you know, and to us, it is the Word of God is a sanctuary.
How about Canada?
I want to come up here. I'm serious.
Go ahead. We're going to hear a brief description of the worship service at Sanctuary, and we're also going to be enlightened as to how many people over 40 worship there.
There are people over 40. I never ask anyone their age personally unless they're around my age. So I don't know how many there are, but by all means, see, because we're definitely, it's just a church. It's not like, you can't come in here, you know? It's like, no, you know? So it's really a church, and we open it to everybody, and we really, you know, are blessed when whoever comes. And so it's really a wide perspective, mostly musicians right now, but, you know, I'm sure that, you know, Lord just blesses with a huge new place to move into, so as we explode, you know, there's all types, really. And also the second part was, oh yeah, the worship team. Well, basically, our worship services are primarily the same as your church, with the exception of the fact that, okay, for instance, right now, what we do is, instead of doing some of the older traditional hymns, we simply have the musicians of our fellowship introduce new hymns. So what we do is we just do, you know, acoustic guitar, bass guitar, some drums and some vocals, you know, praise tunes. But the people at the church write them, so that they're, you know, just, you know, the really cool tunes and everything. And we're not going to copyright them, so you guys can use them. If you ever hear them, feel free to write them and use them. That's no problem. But in any case, so along those lines, also one of the things, you know, we really encourage people to do, and as I'd encourage you guys to, even like tomorrow at Commission, when you hear these guys singing praise tunes to the Lord, don't watch them. Praise God with them. And that's the thing. We really encourage people at church, you know, don't look at the words. I mean, look at them until you memorize them, you know, the first couple of weeks or what have you. But get into what's being said, the praise that is being given, and direction, have it directional towards the Lord. Don't, you know, that's what we do, you know, so that's the, you know, that's what we encourage.
Yeah, I think I heard folks, a friend of mine heard from some guys who saw, they said, vengeance off stage is really neat. And talking to you today, I've seen that. Well, you're definitely not anything that I would say, wow, I want to be like Roger, you know, style-wise, yeah, Christ is my main focus. What I want to know is, how can I base my life on the scriptures so far that, I mean, hey, I'm a man. I wear weird clothes, I talk weird, I walk weird, I act weird. All right, I'm a man. But how can I live my life so that I'm me, Christ, and still maintain my personality?
Wow. For those of you in the back that didn't hear that, we've got a banger up here that's a radical. And he wants to be meek for Christ. And he wants to know how to do it.
And you know, basically what it boils down to is obedience to the Word of God, because the term meek literally means strength, under control. Meaning it goes back to that thing, you know, I'm sure that there are several of us here who physically could do some very serious damage to, you know, someone if we wanted to, if we needed to, you know, if we were attacked, or if you're an attacker, God forbid, you know. But the thing is, meekness is strength under control, meaning I can give you an example. For instance, it's like, you know, a gun. Now, any fool can pull the trigger of a gun, you know, and meekness is not using a gun to harm people, but only using it for protection, you know. So you have issues. I think an individual who I will feel free to, you know, bring out as a prime example, Raul Ruiz, who's a kung fu master in the martial arts. Here is a man who knows several ways to kill a person within a matter of seconds. Here's a man who can harm you, who can dislocate members and send you to the hospital, knowing that you're basically okay. I mean, you're in some serious pain and you're gonna have to deal through healing, but he knows how to put you in pain. See, meekness is strength under control. And that boils even down to our actions and our attitudes, not only physically. For instance, the scripture calls us to husbands to love our wives. I was dealing with a couple recently, and the husband was yelling at his wife. You know, yelling at his wife. Now here's the one who walked up and said, oh yes, I'm going to love and cherish her, and she's going to be mine until death do us part. And here he is yelling at the person he said he was going to love and cherish. That's not love and cherishing. And I explained to him, you know, I said, hey man, and the thing is, well, you know, he said, well, sometimes, you know, situations arise and she just starts doing this and that, and I start yelling at her and hitting things. And I confronted him hardcore, and he didn't yell at me once, you know. The issue was, I explained to him, I said, do you understand that I've confronted you? You've not yelled at me because you respect me. You've not yelled at me because you don't want to yell at me. So the thing was, you know, he understood that out of that respect, and just out of, you know, the situation, he wasn't going to yell at me. But yet, if the same thing had been brought up by his wife, he'd yell at her. So meekness and anger and things of this nature are a choice. Meaning when you talk to people, you know, you got to be who you are, but you want to be gentle and loving, persuasive with the word of God, but you want to be obedient to the scripture and never, you know, to the never allowing yourself just to go beyond what you know scripture calls you to do, you know. And so, if, you know, we're going to retain our personality, but you want to, the character, who you are, the reason that you are what you are, is going to make the whole difference. And if, again, you center it around Jesus Christ, not around Satan. Some people get their life centered around Satan. You know, oh, I'm going to do this, I'm going to cast Satan out of here, and I'm going to do that to Satan, and blah, 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 blah. If you do that, you're going to see Satan's got your eyes off God onto him. You see, even Daniel understood there was something very serious going down. He did not pray against Satan. He prayed to God that the Lord would affect the realm of the physical. And God sent angels to deal in the realm of the spirit. Daniel had no idea what was going on. He had no idea what was going on in the spirit. And really, so you need to understand that. Whenever you pray to the Lord that he would deal with the situation in the spirit. Never pray to Satan. Unless, again, it's an authentic demonic possession. But even that's to be tested, the Bible says. I've never come up against an authentically demon-possessed person. And believe me, the day I do, I'm sure I'll know it. But the point being, you know, I've dealt with many people who had medical problems or what have you. And I praise God, even the Catholic Church just recently, they performed an exorcism. But yet, first they put this person through every physiological, psychological test that was available to understand this wasn't a chemical imbalance. This was not a psychological problem. This person was authentically, demonically possessed, and they performed the exorcism. So, you know, there's a balance in Scripture that you need to maintain, testing all things as Scripture says, holding on to that which is good, and casting aside that which is not.
Where are you guys going to tour?
Why are you going to tour?
We're going to be touring. We're leaving the first week of September. We're going to be coming back through here. I'm going to have a phone number later on today that I can give you guys just to know where we're going to be. So we're going to be back up through here later on in September during that month. So exactly where, I don't know, but I will have a number later on. You can call and find out.
I don't know.
Who knows? We got time for maybe one more, and then we're going to wrap it up. Roger's going to be at the park stage later tonight. He's going to have a teaching, and he's going to minister the word of God to us. He's going to be around the grounds, and I'm sure he'll answer all of your questions. If you just stop him for a minute. He's very accessible to everyone, so we do have time for another one here.
Roger, your speaking voice is nothing like your singing voice. What do you do when you sing and make it sound
that way? Yes, as a matter of fact, you know, you have been compared. This gentleman here asked him about his singing voice and his speaking voice. You have been compared to Freddy Krueger when you sing. What do you do to prepare your voice for that vocal range?
Good Big Mac and a shake. No, I'm joking. You know, it's really heavy because, and that's, I'm glad you brought the one point out about the Krueger thing. Because I just won't, and in closing and in answering that question too, let us keep in mind the difference between Hollywood and biblical reality. Hollywood has laid a perception on the country, and I guess New York too, there's filming here, that the demonic is some girl spitting out, you know, avocado juice out of her mouth, you know, or that it's Freddy Krueger, you know, or that it's, you know, Jason, some full on earth alien, you know. But the Bible says that Satan was the most beautiful angel created, that which is most seductive. It says that he comes as an angel of light. Not as some full-on, you know, his head rips around twice and, you know, green stuff. You know, he's not going to deceive too many people that way, you know what I'm saying? He comes very subtly. And, you know, and it's interesting because Nicholas Schreck, as our, we have a vengeance video that's going to, we're going to be bringing on tour with us. It opens with a quote from Nicholas Schreck from the Church of Satan. Now, this is, we're talking Anton LaVey, Nicholas Schreck, Church of Satan, you know, the Satanic Bible Church of Satan. And, he pointed out, he goes, you know, when people talk about satanic music, he goes, you people who say that we listen to this heavy metal junk, he goes, you idiots, we listen to the great classical composers, the satanic composers such as Richard Wagner, Rachmaninoff. This is truly satanic music, not this heavy metal junk. So you gotta understand, now, you know, see what I'm saying? The reality of what is happening in the world and the perception that many groups play, you know, they're selling books and newspapers and articles on this type of stuff, you know. Baffert masking, now come on, give me a break, man. Like Jeff was saying, you know, they're telling you to break every commandment that God ever laid down forward, and you gotta play it backwards, you know what I'm saying? Give me a break. So in any case, but you know, basically, I'm just screaming into the mic. You know?
I love this guy. One more. Bad.
Speak up, please.
You want to know if they'll use some of the lyrics that people send in?
Basically, we can't. Basically, it would involve too much of a legal issue, you know, and literally it did on our first album. This one dude, oh yeah, guys, use my music or use my lyrics. We used some. He sued us. Well, come on, man. Hey, what's going on? So because of that, we're still dealing with that. Today. I couldn't believe it. He told everybody, yeah, man, Vince is going to use my stuff. Hey, Brett, go for it, man. I was like, well, how much would you like? Oh, nothing. Just use it. It's okay with me. Just put my name on the album. Put his name on the album. He sued us. So our management won't let us. And we probably won't. Yeah, so we could do that. But, you know, we'll review lyrics if someone wants to send them in.
Okay, we're going to wrap it up because there's other people that are coming in here and there's a lot of other things going on. I do want to remind you once again that Roger will be ministering tonight at the Park Stage. Check the schedules. I think it's 9 o'clock. Okay? Check your schedules. I do want to call on all of you, whenever you are in prayer today, whenever you are in prayer, I would like very much to ask you, please, to keep the town of Palmyra in your prayer. Just keep that town and lift up the name of Jesus Christ. Claim that area for Jesus, that town of Palmyra be holy ground and that Jesus will reign there. Once again, thank you, Roger. We love you. Thank you.